Let me introduce myself. I'm Mohan Ramanan. I teach at the University of Hyderabad. Today, I'm going to speak on Indian English poets. They are, of course, part of this glorious and long tradition of Indian English writing, which, as you know, has about 150 years of history. It is one of those traditions which can be seen in two ways. One as a tributary of English literature, which is how people like Professor K.R. Srinivasayyengar saw it when he, for example, delivered his first series of lectures in the University of Leeds on Indian writing in English. He called it Indo-Anglian literature at that time. The other way of looking at it is that this is a literature in English. It is not a tributary of English literature, but it is an independent literature in English. And I think that is a better way of looking at writing coming from different parts of the world, where English may be the medium of expression, but certainly the ideology and the culture is not necessarily English or British or even Anglo-Saxon. So today, I will be dealing with Kamala Das, who is a very senior writer, but of course she's no more now, and she passed away in 2009. She was born in 1934, and she has had a very checkered and very colorful literary career, not to speak of a very colorful personal life. So I have chosen one poem by Kamala Das, which is a very highly anthologized poem. And it is probably the first poem in her collection of poetry, in her collected works. And it is simply called Introduction. That's, I think, a very appropriate way of dealing with a major writer. But as I said, Kamala Das is a poet who was born in 1934 and died 2009. She has a very well-known literary pedigree as well. Her mother was the well-known Malayalam poet Balamani Ammal. Everybody knows about her in Kerala. And her father was the well-known V.M. Nair, who for some time managed the Malayala Manorama or Matribhumi, I think one of those two newspapers, for a long time. And they came from an extremely well-to-do Nair household, a Tharavad called Nalapat, okay? And that is an important starting point for an understanding Kamala Das, because she has certain kinds of roots, and her poetry is definitely going to speak about those roots, not necessarily with great admiration for it. You can be part of something and yet not like what you're part of. And I think in Kamala Das's case, there are two or three levels at which she is not happy with what she is. One is the fact that she belongs to a very orthodox family or a very orthodox community, and where caste prejudices and class prejudices are, of course, very, very strong. And this means that a society like that is unlikely to look very favorably at a woman who wants to express herself very freely. In Kamala Das's case, that desire for self-expression took two forms. One was her obvious desire to write, her desire to write poetry and fiction. And she wrote a good part of her work is in Malayalam, okay? Let's not forget that. But she also translated into English, and she also wrote originally in English. So she has a considerable body of writing both in Malayalam and in English. So self-expression in two languages, all right? And she says she dreams in one. Right, and she knows too. And you know, so language is a very important part of the rootedness or the culture from which she springs. The second problem with Kamala Das is her obvious desire for sexual expression, and she celebrates the body, and she is not ashamed of the body and its needs. And this, of course, goes counter to traditional expectations from women, the need to, you know, cover yourself, the need to be restrained, the need not to, you know, come out too often, you know, that kind of thing, the parda kind of idea, which is a generic expression for all kinds of oppression and suppression of women. So at these two levels, you find that Kamala Das wants to express herself. So she's not comfortable with a patriarchal family system which refuses to give woman space, or which expects woman to be bounded by a space carved out by the patriarchy, and which also decides on the kind of, you know, roles a woman can play, that she must be either a good daughter or a good wife or a good mother. These are the only expectations. Be a good cook, maybe do some embroidery, and you know, the kind of expectations which are there in traditional societies. So that is something which you need to keep in mind. And a third very important level at which Kamala Das figures is in her deep spirituality. That is something which many people don't often recognize. At the age of 42, she wrote an autobiographical work called My Story. And it was a completely explicit, sexually explicit kind of book, where she very freely discussed her affairs and her loves and her bodily needs and so on. And society was shocked. But then, we must also understand that in Indian tradition, particularly in the devotional tradition of India, the bhakti tradition, every one of the bhakti poets in this country, and I think of Andal, the great Tamil poet, for example, or Mirabai in the north, or Chaitanya in the east, these are all people who are craving for union with God. But that craving is always seen or shown or demonstrated or expressed in terms of human love. So the strong erotic content in bhakti poetry is something which we should never lose sight of. Because you can't express an abstract love for God except in terms of the love which you understand, which is human love. So unless you go through the body, you cannot get to the soul. And that is how bhakti poetry has operated in our country. And my view is that Kamala Das is capable of two kinds of bhakti poetry. One is saguna bhakti, that is bhakti with form, seeing God in terms of attributes, in terms of, you know, qualities, and the ability to give a name to God, like Rama or Krishna. In fact, she has at least three or four very beautiful poems on Krishna bhakti. And the Radha Krishna story is an important element in her spiritual evolution. But then she's also capable of what we might call nirguna bhakti, that is, bhakti or realization or expression of godliness or divinity in terms of God without form, God without attributes, which is of course a very high philosophical level at which one is functioning. And these traits are to be seen in a series of poems called the Anamalai poems, which she wrote in late life, because once you have exhausted the possibilities of human love, once you have exhausted the experiences of being human, and then you go to the hills, and then you participate in the divinity of nature, then you move beyond the body into some disembodied state of metaphysical transcendence. And I think you find in Kamala Das that spiritual quality as well. So I would in fact argue, and I have done that before, that Kamala Das is a deeply religious poet. And that aspect of her poetry is sometimes obscured by everybody, you know, tacking on to the fact, oh, that she is a sexually explicit writer, or that she is talking about a feminist perspective to life, about woman and man's relationship with woman, and so on, which is all true. But there's also this other very, very important dimension. And you can't read a poet and say that I have read the introduction, I know Kamala Das. You can't say that. You cannot simply reduce a poet to one or two poems. In order to understand a poet fully, you have to understand him or her in totality. And if you look at it that way, then I would suggest that Kamala Das is a deeply spiritual poet. If you want to use the word spiritual rather than religious, it's okay with me. Because religion sometimes means some forms, some rituals, some accepted ways of looking at God. But spirituality goes beyond narrow domestic walls, narrow religious walls. It allows you to see the spirit, and the spirit is universal, and it has nothing whatsoever to do with any particular religious denomination or sect. All right? So I think this is the true Kamala Das for me. The poem I have chosen is an introduction, and it's an introduction to Kamala Das. It begins with her distaste for politics, which of course many of us have. We don't particularly care for politicians, and I think in those early years of Indian democracy, there was the same sense of disappointment with politicians. Many of them won independence for us, but then they went on to become rulers, and then they descended into the same kind of political quagmire which we now see in our own times. So Kamala Das doesn't know politics, she says, but I know all the names of the people in power, beginning with Nehru. So it means that we are talking about post-1947 India, and this is one of the early poems written by Kamala Das in the 1950s, when Nehru was very much the prime minister of this country. Then she goes on to say that, I am an Indian. I have been born in Malabar. So she gives you a number of details about her own roots. I told you how her roots are important. So she's Indian. She has a color of the skin which is brown. Immediately we remember that there is racism in the world. And then she's, you know, defining herself against a predominantly white culture which is associated with the English language and with and her own Indianness is in a way concentrated in the fact that she is a woman of color. And she says she is born in Malabar, and I speak three languages. I presume she knew Malayalam, English, and Hindi. That's my impression, or even Bengali, because she grew up in Calcutta. Her parents were in Calcutta for a long time. And in fact, her very first collection of poems is called Summer in Calcutta, which is, of course, very autobiographical. So I don't know which is the third language, but definitely English, because she is capable of expressing herself in that. But people tell her what to do and what not to do. Don't write in English, they say. It's not our language. And then she says, why don't you leave me alone? I need my space as a woman and as a writer and as a thinker. I don't want critics like you and me, critics of literature. I don't want you critics to tell me what I should do. I certainly don't want friends to be telling me how I should behave. And I don't want visiting cousins to be telling me again how I should determine my life. And visiting cousins is a wonderful reference to the fact that she belonged to a Tharavad, a Nayar Tharavad in Kerala, Nalapat. And people come and go in these big homes in Kerala. There's a lot of coming and going, lot of relatives. And so for a modern person, too many people around also is a problem. You don't have space and you want to live your own life. So why not leave me alone, critics, friends, visiting cousins, every one of you? Why not let me speak in any language I like? So the first part of the poem then is a definition of what she might want to be and what she is not and what she wants to be. And then the politics of language is an important idea here. Because remember that many people used to say that if you write in English, you cannot possibly express the soul of India. because English is a foreign language. But many Indian English poets have grappled with this problem of language. And all of them have felt, and a person like Kamala Das very clearly, that it's only a medium and I'm comfortable speaking in English or writing in English. So who are you to tell me I shouldn't write in it? I am able to express myself and that's enough. And in her case, she's bilingual. She knows Malayalam and English and comfortable in both languages. So what's the problem here? Why should you tell me what I should do or what I should not do? So the language I speak becomes mine, even if it's a faulty English, ungrammatical English, like that wonderful poem by Nisim Ezekiel, Goodbye Party for Miss Pushpa T.S. Remember? All those present continuous tense sentences. Even if it is faulty, it is our own English. And I am, after 30 or 35 years in the profession of teaching English, of the opinion that there are as many Englishes as there are people speaking English. And there's no one standard by which one needs to, you know, determine. Of course, somewhere, some grammar and some syntax will need to be kept in mind. But there are turns of expression which are very colorful and Indianisms which I think all of us understand as having contributed something to the English language, which the English language would be impoverished by if it didn't have it. So the language I speak becomes mine. Its distortions, its queernesses, these are all mine, mine alone, she says. It is half English, half Indian, funny perhaps, but it is honest. It is honest. And it is as human as I am human. Can't you see that? So she says that I am speaking in the English language, no doubt. But I am speaking myself. I am expressing myself. It is human. Can't you see that? And what does it do? It voices my joys, my longings, my hopes. It is useful to me. Just as cawing comes naturally to a crow or roaring comes naturally to a lion, English comes naturally to me. My own Indian English poetry is mine. And that's it. Don't question it. It is the speech of the mind, she says. Look at that expression, speech of the mind. It is human speech, and it is here and not there. A mind that sees and hears and is aware. Every aspect of it, awareness is, you know, allowed to flow through the expressions in English which I have. So it is very authentic for me. So don't you tell me whether, you know, that I should not write in English. I will continue to do that. And then she contrasts it with the deaf and blind speech of trees in storm or of monsoon clouds or of rain or the incoherent mutterings of the blazing funeral pyre. You can see the number of images she gives you here, which are all, of course, in a way about nature. And then much of nature is incoherent. We don't know what's going on there. It is different from that. When I'm speaking, I speak myself. I speak about myself. And it is me coming through in my speech. I was a child. Now she moves, takes the argument away from the politics of language to what she is as a human being. I was a child. And later they told me I grew, for I became tall, my limbs swelled, and one or two places sprouted hair when I asked for love. And she, the deep sexuality of her life is coming through here. When I asked for love, not knowing what else to ask for, my father, he, or somebody, some patriarchal person, drew a youth of 16 into the bedroom and closed the door. So I was married to a man who was 16 years old. Now he did not beat me, but my sad woman body felt so beaten, so defeated by this experience of having someone whom I did not care for, whom I could not love, and who did not love me. The weight of my breasts and womb crushed me. I shrank pitifully. You see, shrinking pitifully shows you the extent of the deterioration, the decline in the person. Then, in order to avoid feeling defeated as a girl, I decided I'll become a boy. So I began wearing shirts. My brother's trousers, for example, is what I wore. I cut my hair short and ignored my womanliness in order to assert myself. All right? Dress in saris, they said. You cannot dress like this. You dress in saris. Be a girl, be a wife, they said. Be embroiderer, be cook, be a quarreler with servants, which is, of course, a very funny way of, you know, describing what happens in many, many domestic contexts, where the servants are the butt of all the anger of the wife or of the woman in the house. Fit in, So you see, you have to fit in to a prefabricated structure of society. You cannot deviate from it. You have no right to, because you are a girl. Therefore, you must live like that. Oh, belong, cried the categorizers. Categorizers, people who categorize you, formulate you in a phrase, and leave you wriggling on the wall, as T.S. Eliot puts it in that wonderful, wonderful poem, Prufrock poem, The Love Song of J. Alfred Prufrock. So have a name. Be Amy, it's an American name perhaps, or be Kamala, because she's Kamala Das, or better still be Madhavi Kutty, because her name in Malayalam is Madhavi Kutty. Kamala Das is her pseudonym in English. Madhavi Kutty, the daughter of Balamani Ammal. That's how most people know her in Kerala. And then she had another name change in late life. In 1999, I believe, she converted to Islam and she became Kamala Suraya. And in fact, when she died in 2009, she was buried in a mosque, in a graveyard belonging to a mosque. So from a Nayar woman to a modern English poet to an Islamic person, a person professing Islam. So there are many, many personalities in Kamala Das. That's why I called her a colorful person. It is time to choose a name, a role. You got to have a name. You cannot be anybody. You got to have a name. You got to be either Kamala Das, or you got to be Madhavi Kutty, or you can be called Amy, whatever, but you must have a name. You have to have a role. You must be either a wife, or a daughter, or a husband, or whatever. You know, it works both ways. For men also, we are also condemned to certain kinds of roles in life. Don't play pretending games. Don't play at schizophrenia. Don't be a nympho. Nympho is one who's got sexual appetites which are uncontrollable. And, you know, very often people used to even criticize Kamala Das as some kind of a nymphomaniac. All right? So that is why she is referring to this. Don't cry embarrassingly loud when jilted in love. All these things are do's and do's and don'ts. Thou shalt not. The culture of thou shalt not. Then she says, that doesn't matter. I am going to do what I have to do. I met a man, loved him. Call him not by any name. He's every man who wants a woman. So even though I married a person or I met a man, I am representing not just Kamala Das, but all women. All women, not just one woman, but all women, womankind. And I married a man. He is every man who wants a woman, just as I am every woman who seeks love. In him, in the man, a hungry haste of rivers, a desire to satiate his sexuality. In me, the capacity to wait and then to be patient. Because a woman traditionally is supposed to have that capacity to bear. The hungry haste of rivers in me, the ocean's tireless waiting. Who are you? I ask each and every one. The answer is, it is I. And at this point, I feel that Kamala Das is slowly moving away from what we might call body politics. Linguistic politics is over, language politics, body politics is over. Now she is talking about the I. And the I, as you know, is like, you know, the Vedantic sense of the soul, of the Atman, and its similarity or its identity with the Brahman, you know, that kind of thing. I believe there is in this poem, finally, a little hint of the kind of things she is going to do in later poetry, where she is now interested in the I. Who am I? The sense of the individual and the deepest, innermost essence of being. Okay? And that is why the last part goes on like this. I ask each and every one, the answer is, it is I. Anywhere and everywhere, I see the one who calls himself I in this world. He's tightly packed like the sword in its sheath. It is I who drink lonely drinks at 12, midnight in hotels of strange towns. It is I who laugh. It is I who make love and then feel shame. It is I who die dying with a rattle in my throat. I am sinner. I am saint. All kinds of possibilities, but there is an I, which is the common factor here. And that is where, I think, in my opinion, Kamala Das is moving towards a desire or a trajectory in the poem of self-realization. Okay? And she's really saying that after all the role-playing is done, after all the battles are fought and won, there is a problem of essential identity. What is it that I am? The I-ness in me has to be realized. And that is how the poem ends. It is I who make love and then feel shame. It is I who lie dying with a rattle in my throat. I am sinner. I am saint. I am the beloved and the betrayed. I have no joys that are not yours, no aches which are not yours. I too call myself I. You know this poem, I too am America. Remember that line in Leaves of Grass? I too am America. And this is exactly what she's saying. I too am I. Everybody may have a personality, but I am also capable of stressing my personality. Okay, let me ask you a question. Do you think that the trajectory I developed is something which can be accepted by you, or do you think there is another way of looking at the last part of the poem? I am deliberately moving in the direction of what we might call a spiritual dimension to Kamala Das to keep pace with my introductory remark. But do you think that this poem is leading towards what we might call the spiritual?
The poem tries to realize the spiritual in life, in the universal. I mean, sir, you have mentioned very correctly, I mean, I completely agree with you about the identity crisis or self-assertion that she keeps trying to do. But by the very use of the personal pronoun I, particularly towards the end, she makes herself universal. Perhaps, I mean, this is just a thesis.
Yeah.
Perhaps.
No, I think you're right. You're on the right track.
I mean, through the
universal dimensions of the individual. But that means the individual is an individual who participates in the eternal. And this is very close to what I might call the Advaitic truth of the Brahman and the Atman being one and the same. And she's not unaware of these things, because her poetry definitely touches on the philosophical dimensions, particularly Hindu philosophy. And that she was constantly questing for God is clear when she converts to Islam finally in the last part of her life. There must have been some dissatisfaction with Hindu society or with the Hindu way of living for her to have done that. Yeah.
So can one then say that perhaps through this self-assertion, through her realization of her individuality, she may achieve or has already achieved perhaps the universal? Because at the end she becomes universal. She recounts or relives everything that a basic human being can feel, making language and politics of sex all recede behind her.
Yes.
Can one say that?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, you're putting what I've said in slightly different words, but I think essentially you seem to be agreeing with the point I have made. Is there anyone who disagrees with the two of us? Yeah. You agree with the basic interpretation? Now, I want to close this by saying that in literary interpretation, there is no such thing as closure. Nothing is said for the last time. There's no ending in these matters. Somewhere, we have to leave things a little open. And I think the quality of suggestion which poetry has is available in Kamala Das. Even though she's so direct, so forthright, I think she's not lacking in suggestiveness. And where there is suggestiveness, there is possibility of meaning, multiple meanings. And I think you should leave the poem always with the sense that when I come back to it again, maybe 10 years later, I'm going to find something more in this poem than I found today. Okay? Thank you.